Good morning, and welcome this morning to our fourth Sunday of Advent service here at Sistersville First United Methodist Church. We're glad to have you here with us in the house of God this morning. We welcome everybody that's in person, those online, those that are listening via the radio. If you're watching with us online, please say hi to us. Sheena's in the back, and she'll say hi right back to you. And if you have any questions or something goes wrong, just let us know. We'll be happy to get that fixed, but we'd love to know who's with us as you're watching online. Let us begin our worship service this morning by the lighting of our Advent candles. I'm going to invite the Morgan family to come forward as they do a reading and light the candles for us.
For to us a child is born, to us a son is given, and a government shall be upon his shoulder, and his name shall be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Of the increase of his government and of peace there will be no end, on the throne of David and over his kingdom, to establish it and uphold it with justice and with righteousness from this time forth and forevermore. The zeal of the Lord of hosts will do this. We light this candle as a symbol of the Prince of Peace. May the visitation of your Holy Spirit, O God, make us ready for the coming of Jesus, our hope and joy. O come, Emmanuel.
I invite you to please stand and let's join together in our call to worship this morning. All through this season of Advent, we have encountered hope, peace, and joy. Today we will hear the story of surprising commitment. Today we will be challenged to believe in all that God can do. And we join together in the opening prayer. Holy God, your prophet Micah foretold with faith that a new ruler would come forth from Bethlehem. Today we celebrate the fulfillment of your promise. Your daughter Elizabeth proclaimed with faith that her cousin was to be the mother of her Lord. Today we celebrate the fulfillment of your promise. Your servant Mary proclaimed with faith that she would be called blessed by all nations. Today we celebrate the fulfillment of your promise. Make us bold enough to proclaim with faith the coming of your kingdom, the coming of your justice, and the coming of your peace. May we sing out of the good news of your salvation, trusting in fulfillment of your promises. All this we pray in the name of the one who comes. Amen. I'm going to invite our praise team to come forward and invite all of us to join together.
Good morning, church family. I just invite you to join us as we think about God's gift to us and anticipate his second coming. This is a traditional Christmas carol, but it's not quite so traditional. It's not that hard. You'll get it.
We have heard on high, sweetly singing o'er the plains, and the mountains in reply echo back their joyous strains, their joyous strains.
Gloria, Gloria, Gloria.
So I remember a few months ago when we couldn't even get together and meet in this room. And then I remember after that we could meet in this room, but we couldn't sing and worship together. And I remember one Sunday that Pat played a video of this next song. It's a combination of Agnes Dei and King of Kings. And I remember I wanted to sing so bad. And now we can. So it's a privilege to be able to worship God. No matter what you sound like, there is just something meaningful about raising your voice and recognizing Him as our King of Kings.
For the Lamb had conquered death.
And the dead rose from their tombs, and the angels stood in awe. For the souls of all who come to the Father are restored. And the church of Christ was born. Then the Spirit in the flame. Now this God is through the bolt. Shall not kneel, shall not faint. By his blood and hear his name. In his freedom I am free. For the love of Jesus Christ, who has resurrected me. Praise the Father, praise the Son, praise the Spirit, three in one. God of glory, majesty, praise forever to the King of Kings. Son, praise the Spirit, three in one. God of glory, majesty, praise forever to the King of Kings. Praise forever to the King of Kings.
Let us now hear from our good friend Douglas, who's going to talk to us today about Christmas trees.
Oh, Christmas tree, oh, Christmas tree, your leaves are so unchanging. Hey guys, it's me again, Douglas, and we're about to go decorate our Christmas tree, and I love decorating the Christmas tree. Christmas trees are so awesome. I love Christmas trees. And I've always loved Christmas trees, even when I was a teeny tiny little baby. In fact, when I was so little that I couldn't even roll over yet, my mom and dad, they put up the Christmas tree, and my mom, she put me on the floor on a little blanket in the middle of the living room, and the Christmas tree was in there, and I was looking up at the Christmas tree. And my mom went into the kitchen to go warm up my bottle, and when she came back, I was gone. And she thought that I had, like, been Douglas napped or something like that. She thought I was gone forever. She was so scared, and she's running around the house trying to find me, but then she heard a little tiny baby Douglas giggle. And I had rolled over for the first time. I had rolled over and then rolled over again and again and again several times, and I rolled under the Christmas tree. And I was underneath the tree, and I was looking up at the tree from underneath, and I could see the lights. And apparently I really liked it because my mom said that I was laughing a lot when I was down there. But, you know, I've been looking into a lot of these traditions that we have, these Christmas traditions, and it turns out that a lot of them are not in the Bible. And, you know, I think that's okay. I think it's okay for us to have these other traditions like Christmas trees and Christmas lights and giving presents and things like that, stuff that isn't in the Bible, so long as it all points us back to what is really important. If you ever start thinking that Christmas is about Christmas trees, that's not good. Christmas is about how God sent his son Jesus to save us from our sins. We're celebrating the birth of Jesus Christ. All the Christmas traditions that we have are all well and good, but if they pull us away from what's most important, that is not good. But a Christmas tree absolutely reminds me of what's important. Because see, there's actually some cool symbolism behind a Christmas tree. Because see, when we make a Christmas tree, we make it out of an evergreen tree. We make it out of a tree that is green all the time, even in the winter. So you know how in fall everything is all pretty because it's all getting red and orange and yellow and all the leaves are falling? Well, essentially, all those pretty leaves is just those trees giving up for the winter. Times get hard and those trees are like, well, I'll be back in the spring when it gets warm. See you later, guys. And they're pretty much dead all through the winter when the weather's nasty. But evergreen trees are green all the time, not just in the summer, but even in the winter when things are cold and nasty. And we use an evergreen tree for our Christmas trees because just like an evergreen tree is constant and unchanging even when times are tough, so it is God's love and his promise to you and to me and to everybody. Just like an evergreen tree is green all the time, even when times are tough, God loves you and me and all of us all the time, even when times are tough. And he's never going to go back on his promises. You know, the Bible is absolutely full of God keeping his promises to his people. But it's also full of God's people not trusting that God's going to come through for them. But on Christmas, we celebrate the fact that God kept his promise. And he sent his son, Jesus, to be our Savior. God's love for us is eternal and unchanging. You know, the other thing that the Christmas tree reminds me of is it doesn't take a break. You know, in the Bible, it says that when the angels came down and they talked to the shepherds and they told them that baby Jesus was born, they said that this good news was for all the people. And they didn't just mean all the people in that season. You know, they didn't just mean all the people in Bethlehem or even the world at that time. They meant all the people, everywhere, ever. This gift of Jesus Christ is an eternal gift, a gift for all the people. And all we have to do is accept that gift. God keeps his promises, and his love is never failing. So I hope that this Christmas season, as you are putting up your Christmas tree, or if you see a beautiful tree with awesome lights and decorations and things like that, I hope that those trees will remind you of God's unfailing love. And I hope that when you and I see a Christmas tree this year, that it will bid us all place faithfully our trust in God, unchanging. Merry Christmas, guys.
Let's join together in the children's prayer. Jesus, be a friend to me. Keep me ever close to thee. Teach me to be pure and true. Show me what I ought to do. Amen. If any of the children would like to go to children's church, Gary has agreed to, and thank you, Gary, to do children's church today. So if you'd like to follow Gary downstairs, you're more than welcome to do so. We've come to a time of offering our joys and concerns to God this morning. And I invite you to share any that you have. If you just want to raise your hand and just shout it out, that's fine. If you're online and have a prayer request, just go ahead and list it right there in the comments. We'll be happy to pray with you. Any requests or joys or celebrations today? Becky? Thank you. Thank you. Any others? We're all really quiet today. Here. You guys got to go. Any others? Okay, if not, let us pray and we'll close with our Lord's Prayer. Gracious and loving God, as we gather here this day, on our last Sunday of the season of Advent, we have been preparing our hearts and minds with the hope and the love and the joy and the peace of your Son, Jesus Christ. As we light the four Advent candles to commemorate each week, each has a different symbol, a different meaning, as you know, and it all relates to your son Jesus and preparing our hearts and minds for this coming season and celebrating his birth. We know this is a busy time of year, Lord, and in our lives, whether it's work or whether it's through school or just the Christmas get-together parties, the celebrations, the events, all the things happening in the life of the church, there's a lot going on. And as Douglas said, all those things are great as long as the true meaning of Christmas, that is the birth of Jesus Christ, continues to ring out into the world so that others may come to know why we celebrate the season and why we gather here by candlelight on Christmas Eve and sing Silent Night and talk about that old holy night, that night of Jesus' birth. Today, Lord, we are eternally grateful for the ways in which you have blessed us here at Sistersville First United Methodist Church and blessed this community through great programs like our Faith Hands ministry, who continually each month serves so many with hygiene items and with food and of course the Family Resource Network as well, being here and then passing out so many different things, like for example yesterday the blankets and the Bibles to go out to those in need, and the 64 that we served in the closet and the 80 meals that went out. Lord, we know it's a thriving ministry, one that is needed in this community, and we're just so thankful that not only can we house this, but also that we can continue to provide for those in need. We're thankful, Lord, for the joy of being able to go see Handel's Messiah, and that was sponsored by the United Methodist Foundation, who do quite a bit of work throughout our conference and offer such neat events like this. And Lord, we just ask that you continue to bless our conference here in West Virginia, continue to bless the United Methodist Foundation so they can continue to offer such wonderful events. And we're thankful to hear the music of Handel's Messiah, and that's where so many were able to go. Lord, we're drawing a close to this one season, but a new one's about to begin here on Friday night. And Lord, as we rush to get everything done in the rest of this week and throughout this week, and we get prepared for our families and friends as we gather, continue to give us peace, Lord, and give us rest at the end of each day. And if certain things don't go according to plan, that's okay. Let us put our faith and trust in you, like so many did from the Christmas story, where they put their faith in you and you allowed things to happen so that those things happened and came to fruition. And that's why we're still here today, celebrating the birth of your son, Jesus Christ. Continue to give us faith. Continue to hear our prayers. And continue to hear the prayers of those online, the silent ones that are on our hearts and minds, those that are listening via the radio. Continue to hear us, Lord. Continue to be with us, as you promised to always do. When two or three are gathered in my name, I will be with you. And Christ told his disciples, I will not leave you abandoned, I will not leave you orphaned. For you are with us, God, throughout this season and throughout each year. Continue to bless us, continue to watch over us. And we pray all this through Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. And now let us join in saying the prayer that he taught us by saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Today's scripture lesson comes from the Gospel according to Luke, chapter 1, verses 11 through 15, and I'll be making some other references from Luke's Gospel as we go through the sermon. But from the English Standard Version, the Gospel writer Luke writes that, And there appeared to him an angel of the Lord standing on the right side of the altar of incense. And Zechariah was troubled when he saw him, and fear fell upon him. But the angel said to him, Do not be afraid, Zechariah, for your prayer has been heard, and your wife Elizabeth will bear you a son, and you shall call his name John, and you will have joy and gladness, and many will rejoice at his birth. For he will be great before the Lord, and he must not drink wine or strong drink, and he will be filled with the Holy Spirit, even from his mother's womb. This is the word of God for us, the people of God. So how many of us in this room have ever made plans before? How many have ever had our plans not go according to the way we had them planned? If you haven't, live a little bit. Because odds are sometime in life something will not go according to the way that we had it planned. Zechariah was a priest who got the high honor of going into the Holy of Holies at the temple in Jerusalem, which is something that only happened once a year. And he got elected they cast lots, and he was elected. He got to go in. He represented a small village, and it was a high honor for him. A man who lived in a lifetime in the priesthood, and it was devoted to God and worshiping God day in and day out. Now he, like many, had hoped when he and his wife were married that they would have children. Unfortunately, that didn't come to pass for many years. And in fact, although we don't know his age, let's just say he's 100 by the time he goes into the temple, and let's say Elizabeth is 98. Okay. And because we really don't know how old they are, but we know that by what Zechariah says next, they're way past the age of having children, and they've accepted this. So their original plan didn't go according to what they had hoped or their plan, but did it? Did it go according to plan? Just not on the time frame in which they had expected it to happen. Notice that in the next few verses, in chapter 1, verse 18, and Zechariah said to the angel, "How shall I know this? For I am an old man, and my wife is advanced in years." He puts that so delicately, doesn't he? Yeah. And the angel answered him, "I am Gabriel. I stand in the presence of God, and I was sent to speak to you and bring to you this good news. And behold, you will be silent and unable to speak until the day that these things take place, because you did not believe my words, which will be fulfilled in their time." And the people were waiting for Zechariah, and they were wondering at his delay in the temple. And when he came out, he was unable to speak to them, and they realized that he had seen a vision. And he kept making signs to them and remained mute. And when his time of service was ended, he went to his home. After these days, his wife Elizabeth conceived, and for 5 months she kept herself hidden, saying, "Thus the Lord has done for me in the days when he looked on me to take away my reproach among people." So a man who has devoted his entire life to the priesthood and an entire life to God gets this high honor of going into the Holy of Holies. So imagine this sanctuary. We've got like three basic sections here. That back there is like the outer court, just past the booth, right where you come in. And then you have this section here, which is where would be the main court where most people would have gathered, of course. And then you had this, imagine a curtain here, right? And then behind this curtain, there's an altar to God, right? And some says just a little throne. It's a Holy of Holies. This is where God rests in the temple. And again, once a year, a high priest can go in there and give offerings to God and pray and talk to God. A man who, before he went in, was probably expecting to maybe see a vision and have a one-on-one conversation with God. That's like the ultimate goal of a priest back in the day. Yes, it's my turn, I got to go in. And then when the moment finally happens, what happens to Zechariah's faith? Out the window. In fact, he's scared out of his wits in that there's an angel, Gabriel, and we don't know what Gabriel looked like. Let's just assume like what we always think. It's very, very bright and glorious, and you notice they always make Gabriel like this really like model looking person, you know, with these blue eyes and this nice looking hair, and I mean, it looks like Fabio or something, you know. And let's just assume it's Fabio, okay? And except probably more Middle Eastern looking. I don't know what the angels look like, but imagine he's there at the altar and he's talking to Zechariah, exactly what Zechariah probably expected to happen, like yes. But when it finally happened, he was scared. I mean, he was probably taking steps backwards, like, I want to go back and run out the door. But the angel had a message for Zechariah and said, "You're going to be a dad." Who isn't excited about that? Oh, wait, you're 100. I'm sorry. That would scare me, too, if I was 100 years old and I got the news I'm going to be a dad for the first time. And Zechariah, he doesn't even talk for a long time. He doesn't know what to say. He's like, then the only thing he could come out of his mouth says, I'm old. My wife is up there in years too. Again, putting it delicately. And saying, wait, this is not possible. And Gabriel's probably shocked at this too. Like, you don't believe in God? Like, that God can do this? I mean, isn't this what you wanted when you came in this door? Didn't you expect to see a vision, or did you just expect to stand here and talk to an empty wall? And he got what he wanted. But it wasn't exactly in the framework or what he had expected once he went in. He had already given up hope of becoming a father and having a child, and they were living life to the best that they could and following the laws and practicing worshiping God and doing everything that a devout Jew would do. But to finally get word at their advanced age that they're going to be parents had to be difficult, had to be a shock, right? I mean, I can only imagine the conversation. Zechariah, well, it really wasn't much of a conversation. I can imagine when he either drew it out or spelled it out or did something to let Elizabeth know, honey, you're pregnant, you're going to have a child. Can you imagine? It's probably a good thing he couldn't talk. I can only imagine her eyes looking at him like, you are nuts. But you know, eventually they came around, right? They came around to the idea that, well, obviously she became pregnant, and they had a son named John, right? Now, John's story, Luke puts it in before Jesus' story, but it's a story that oftentimes gets lost in the shuffle in Advent. Because Advent, we're preparing for Jesus' birth, right? It's easy to forget the other birth that happened a few months before, when the mighty prophet of the Lord is coming to the earth to prepare the way for Christ. Of course, we'll talk more about John and his ministry next month when we celebrate the baptism of Jesus. But John's story is just as important. Not only are they blood relatives, and not only will John leap in his mother's womb when Mary and Jesus show up, you know, when Mary's early on in her pregnancy, but there's something special about what's happening here. Two boys are about to be born that are going to change the world forever. Maybe not when they're young, because we don't get a lot of their stories when they're young, but when they become adults, they're going to change the world. You know, all of us, when we were born, we changed somebody's world. When Julie told me that we were expecting a child, I was super excited. In fact, I'm pretty sure I was actually shoveling snow or something, and I was running around outside, and the neighbors probably thought I was nuts. But I remember nothing could truly prepare me for the day in which the child was born. And nothing could truly prepare me for childhood. Even though I watched my dad closely on how to do it, still couldn't prepare me for being a father. I wouldn't trade it for the world. But what I apparently expected, which again I can't remember what it is not exactly what's happened. I am heavily outnumbered in my household. Steve and I can relate. Steve got a guest room. If you ever need to escape. And I have to admit, I when I expected having children, I got to admit, I don't know if I expected being a girl daddy. But my goodness, I've had so many tea parties. I have, fortunately, the princess dresses do not fit me, so I don't have to worry about that. But I have played characters from the movies and the books. I have read books that I thought I've read them 1,000 times, and guess what? They say the same thing after the 1,000th time. A lot of unexpected things happen, but guess what? I wouldn't trade it for the world. I don't think Zechariah and Elizabeth would have traded it for the world. They probably would have wished they were a little bit younger when John came around, but they were still thrilled to be parents. Still thrilled to be parents. But yet there was doubt in the beginning. Jump over to Luke, chapter 1, but it's verse 26. In the sixth month, the angel Gabriel, so this is the sixth month after Zechariah has been told that he's going to be a father with John, the baby John. So 6 months later, Gabriel shows back up. This time goes north to the city of Galilee, named Nazareth, to a virgin betrothed to a man whose name was Joseph, of the house of David. And the virgin's name was Mary, and he came to her and said, "Greetings, O favored one, the Lord is with you." Now she was greatly troubled at the saying and tried to discern what sort of greeting this might be. And the angel said to her, "Do not be afraid, Mary, for you have found favor with God, and behold, you will conceive in your womb and bear a son, and you shall call his name Jesus. He will be great, and he will be called the Son of the Most High, and the Lord God will give to him the throne of his father David, and he will reign over the house of Jacob forever, and of his kingdom there will be no end." So, somewhat similar kind of greeting. Gabriel shows up and explains why he's there, and we're about ready to have another baby shower. We're going to have another baby, right? Except this time it's a little different. A lot of great titles went with John and in the prophecy of John, but even greater titles are coming with the second baby that is going to be the Son of God. But notice what Mary says. She asks one question. Mary said to the angel, "How will this be since I am a virgin?" It's the only question she asked. How is it physically going to be possible? The angel answered her, "The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. Therefore, the child to be born will be called Holy, the Son of God. And behold, your relative Elizabeth in her old age has also conceived a son, and this is the sixth month with her who was called barren. For nothing will be impossible with God." And Mary said, "Behold, I am the servant of the Lord. Let it be to me according to your word." And the angel departed from her. Now, she quickly jumps on board to whatever God has planned, right? Now, Mary, we assume, is probably a young teenage girl at this time, just recently engaged to Joseph, and as tradition would normally have it, she probably didn't get a whole lot of say in the matter. Although she probably, obviously, she eventually comes to love Joseph, and they have a wonderful life together. And Joseph eventually comes around to this idea of Mary's having a child that's not his, and all the publicity that would go with that. But Mary doesn't ask, or doesn't come up with the excuse, "I'm engaged, this is not going to look good." Notice she never says that. She doesn't say, "I'm worried about what's going to happen to me." All she asked was, "How is this physically going to be possible?" Angel Gabriel quickly gives her an answer, and what does she say? "Yes, let it be done to me according to your word," knowing full well what could potentially happen to her and the child, and how Joseph is going to react to this. Her parents could even shun her and throw her out on the streets for this. But she doesn't ask or worry about those things. She simply just asks God, "How is it going to happen?" And once that is revealed, she says yes. So it's a big difference between her and Zechariah. Zechariah was a priest, a lifelong priest, waiting for that moment to have that vision from God, and waiting probably his whole life to hear he's going to become a dad. And when that all finally comes to pass, he's scared and doesn't believe that it's going to happen. But then you've got this teenage girl who's still trying to figure out what life is all about. Probably just got the news not too long before that she's engaged. She's trying to figure out what life's going to look like from there. And she gets this message from Gabriel saying, "You're going to be a mom." Oh, and by the way, it's not Joseph's. And to add a little bit more pressure, it's God's only son. How in the world did a teenager get it and a priest did not get it? How did he not have the faith that Mary did? It's understandable if she had a lot of questions. She's only a teenager and she's just recently engaged. If she'd had as many questions as Zechariah, it would have been completely understandable. But Zechariah, who, again, was waiting for this, had nothing but questions, had doubt in his mind. And Gabriel told Mary there's nothing impossible with God. And he even reminded her. Remember what's happening to Elizabeth right now. She's pregnant and they said it wasn't even possible. But she believed instantly in spite of all the potential for harm that could be coming her way. She believed. I don't think anybody was going to harm or be upset with Zechariah for becoming a dad. Even at 100 years old, they'd probably been like, "Well, that's okay." But they wouldn't have been shocked by it. I mean, they would have been shocked by the age, but they wouldn't have been shocked that, oh, yeah, well, him and Elizabeth, they've been trying for years. They're going to finally be parents. That wouldn't have been a big deal. But he doubted. He didn't have the faith that he should have had, but Mary did. As far as we know, Mary was not a priestess in the temple. As far as we know, she was probably a devout Jew, probably worshiped God every day with her family, maybe at home or something like that, probably went to what we would now call a synagogue, you know, in town. But she wasn't like Zechariah, who was constantly in the temple worshiping God. But she understood better than he did. The only thing, maybe it's a male-female thing. Nobody's laughing at that? Well, let me explain. Guys, all the men in the room, how often do we get what we're trying, we get it the first time? How often do we understand everything the first time? Yeah, see? Ladies, how often does the man not fully understand what you're trying to tell him? How often are we not paying attention to what you're trying to tell us? How often, if you could put a sign right in front of our face, we'd still not get it? It's just selective hearing, ladies. That's all it is. Maybe that's it. Maybe because she's a female, she gets things a lot faster than men. I don't know. Well, I don't know. If you think about it, though, Joseph only took one vision from Gabriel to understand what was going on, and he got it. He's a guy. Well, it can't be that. But maybe this was part of God's plan. I asked that question in the beginning. How many of you have ever had plans that don't go according to the way you had them planned? Well, Zechariah's story didn't go according to the way he had a plan. I guarantee you, I mean, I'm sure Mary wanted to be a mom someday, but I don't think that's exactly what she had planned. But when God moves, who are we to say no? When God sends an angel to stand face to face with you and deliver a message, who are we to say no? What would have happened if Zechariah would have just laughed at the angel and said, no way, no thanks, you can pass that on to somebody else? What if he would have went home and actually was still talking to Elizabeth, and Elizabeth would have said, no, you're sleeping outside, this is not happening. This is not happening. Well, who would have been John's parents? How would John have come into the world? What if Mary would have said, yeah, there's too much scandal written all over this. This isn't going to happen. I've just recently engaged. I don't need to deal. That's bad enough drama. I don't need to deal with the rest. You know, that's probably what she was thinking. And then Joseph probably thinking, oh, gosh, I'm already in a pickle. I don't need this. You know, this is too crazy. But eventually they all came around and they all said yes to God and trusted and put their trust in God that things were going to happen according to God's plan. They didn't know the outcome. They didn't know the destination. They just knew that what God was telling them, and they eventually trusted in God's word and the promise that he had for both of those children. We know that John did grow up to be a mighty prophet for God, and he paved the way for God, paved the way for Jesus, baptized many before, and then, of course, Jesus himself in the Jordan River. And then from that baptism, Jesus took it from there, and we know what Jesus did. Jesus and John changed the world. Not just the world, their lives or their parents, they changed the world. Everybody has been changed because of what John the Baptist went on to do and what Jesus went on to do. And that's only possible because God made it so. And it's only possible that we are here because we believe it happened. How many of us were there 2,000 years ago? Nobody was there 2,000 years ago? The Bible has a lot of people that lived a long time. Nobody was there 2,000 years ago. But we do believe, right, of what happened 2,000 years ago? What if an angel of the Lord came up, and I'm using Pat because he's in the front row. Sorry, buddy, you sit there. He comes up to you, Pat, and says, hey, Marilyn, I'm going to tell you too because it involves Pat. And Pat, Marilyn, you're going to have another kid right now, and he's going to be a prophet of the Most High. And we'll call him John again. What would you think? If you couldn't see, his mouth was open for a while. She'd be very, yeah, be very, good luck with the conversation. You do, if you need help, let me know. All right, since the two teenage boys are up here, what if
your parents aren't in here.
What if God appeared to both of you, okay, and said, you know, hey, you're going to be engaged next year, okay? And let's say, just split it up. Let's say, Colby, you're gonna have the first child, and yours is going to be a prophet, and you're going to name the prophet Mason, okay? And Mason, you're going to have the second child, and by the way, that second child is the son of God, and you're going to name it Colby. How would you feel about that? You crazy? Which part, the engaged part or having a child with your brother's name? Both. Probably both. I'm so glad your parents are not in this room right now. I couldn't explain it to them. Thanks for being an example, guys. It sounds crazy, doesn't it? It sounds crazy. It sounded crazy to them. That's why there was some questions. But sometimes we need to get out, and pretty much all the time, we need to get out of our own way to let God do His work. And let God do His work through you. He calls all of us to a higher purpose. Don't be afraid of what God can do through you. It was fear that drove Zechariah to become mute for a while. It wasn't fear that was driving Mary to say yes. That's the kind of faith that we need. How many of you have been afraid over the last couple of years? This is not a judgment thing. How many of you have been a little bit, been worried? Let's put that. If you've been sick, I know you've been probably more worried than most. I know when I was in the hospital for 8 days, I was getting a little nervous. Because eventually the doctors weren't telling me anything. And I thought, oh gosh, this is it, you know. And that is not at all what I had planned for September. In fact, I have a list at home of all the different sermons I was going to preach. And thank good Lord Steve was ready and rearing to go. And I apologize, I made it 6 weeks. But I'm glad that you jumped right in. I didn't plan on going to the hospital. I never plan on going to the hospital. That is not part of my plans. In fact, the last time I truly made a lot of plans was right before I went to college. I had three things. I wanted to go to college. I wanted to find my future wife. And I wanted to become an archaeologist. Two out of those three things happened, okay? The archaeologist thing didn't happen. In fact, right now, I don't even like touching dirt, let alone playing in it. So God obviously knew what He was doing there, steering me away from that. But I still question at times going into the ministry and being a pastor. But every time I have to think, I have to stop and say, you know, God, I've got questions, but I know You can handle them. How many of you during the pandemic, and I know it's still going, had doubts, had worries? How many of you trusted in God that we're going to get through this? Now, how many of you want it to be over in a week? How many of you want it to be over in a month? How many of you wanted to wait 5 years? Nobody signs up for that, right? Well, it's been 2 years and counting. Maybe God works on God's time, not ours. That's probably one of the biggest things that we as human beings struggle with, is getting out of our own way and allowing God to do things on God's time. We're always in a hurry. What happens if you get too far ahead of yourself? How many of you ever were running so fast that you tripped on your own shoelaces? How many of you rode your bicycle so fast that when you hit that curb, in your mind you were going to land perfectly right on it instead of going way over the handlebars and landing face first in the pavement? How many of us need to slow down from time to time? Enjoy the scenery. It's hard to enjoy taking a scenic Sunday drive if you're going 80 miles an hour on a 25 mile an hour road. I know 25 mile an hour seems really, really slow. But if you stop and look around every once in a while, you'll find things that you've never seen before. Last night, that's my last example. Last night I went to a dinner at Quinette's with the Friendly Church. And I got stuck. Not by the train. I got stuck in Payton City. There was a tractor trailer trying to turn into the Go Mart there. And I was stuck there probably for 5 minutes because just the traffic coming the other way was just nonstop. In Payton City, I think the speed limit is 35 for people that follow it, right? Right? Okay. Now I'm not telling you how fast I normally go. So to come to a complete stop, and of course you know me, I'm always late, right, for everything. Oh, come on. Hurry up. Well, then there was a tractor trailer, then there was a minivan in front, behind that, but in front of me. Well, when the tractor trailer moved, I'm waiting for this minivan to just to floor it, you know, to get through the rest of town. Instead of 35, let's get like 25. I'm like, I said, there's a sign right around the corner that says like 45. Let's go. Well, instead of looking forward while I was driving, I was looking to the left and the right. Fortunately, the car kept going forward. And I got to the end, towards the end of Payton City, and right where the cemetery is on the right as you go north. And I looked back and I saw five houses I've never seen before. And I was like, wait a minute, we always talk about the houses on this side. Where did these five houses appear from? Then I got to thinking, it's amazing what happens if you slow down and take a look every once in a while. It's amazing what happens if you literally let Jesus take the wheel every once in a while. Great things will happen if you let God make it happen. I will say this, I have a wonderful family. I have a beautiful wife, two beautiful children, had a beautiful dog, which didn't help me much in the gender department. But I have a wonderful life. I wouldn't trade it for the world. But I know that's only possible because God made it possible. If God would have given me dots to connect to get to Julie and to the two girls, I would have gotten lost 1,000 times. And I'm a typical male. When I get lost, guess what I'm not going to do? I'm not going to ask for directions. I'll look at the map, but I'm not asking for directions. If God drew a straight line to where I am today and told me to follow it, if he wouldn't have been there to guide me on that path, I wouldn't have made it. But because I let God do his work through me and throughout my life, and I've got a lot of life left to live, and there'll be bumps, turns, twists, potholes, you name it. We've all been there. But it's the faith in God that gets us to where we need to go. It's our faith in God that gets us to this moment. It's the faith in God that got us to this season. It's the faith in God that gave us Jesus Christ and John the Baptist, the mighty prophet. It's the faith in God that their parents had that made this possible. So we're at the last Sunday of Advent. Are we ready for Christmas? How many of you are ready for Christmas? I think we need to rewind and go back to November. How many of you have been asked that question? Are you ready for Christmas yet? Besides for me. How many of you have come? This is the only answer I can ever give every year. As ready as I'll ever be. Because quite frankly, I don't know what ready for Christmas really is. but I will say this, I am ready to celebrate on Friday night, Christmas Eve. Especially because last year we had to do it virtually. But to be gathered together and to celebrate Christ's birth with people that are gathered here today and people that you may be coming in for just the holidays or people from that the time worked best to come to this church. Those that watch online, I am so excited to celebrate not the gifts under the tree, not the tree itself, but the birth Jesus Christ. All possible because of faith in Jesus himself. That's what this season's about. If you want to put faith in anything, put faith in the reason why we celebrate the season to begin with. Put faith in God. As Luke wrote, and as Gabriel said, all things are possible with who? All things are possible with who? Okay. Oh, thank you. I was getting really worried. I said, I have brain fog. I remember that. All things are possible with God. All light in the world is possible with God. All darkness can be back because of God and because of the light of the world, Jesus Christ. want to share with you before we sing our final hymns just a few announcements. Reminder that tomorrow night, well, tonight, youth from 5:30 to 7 in the social room. I invite all the youth and families, please come out to that. Tomorrow night is the Fellowship of Christian Men. Correct, Danny?
Yeah, one thing I'd like to say about that is this is our December meeting. For those of you who don't know, we meet from third Tuesday every month. But since this is December, I would like to invite men and their wives to come to fellowship with us tonight. We meet at 5:30, we meet at 6:00.
All right, so everybody's welcome.
Yeah,
and they've got plenty of food at Quinette. So if you come eat. Yeah. Come. Okay. Yeah, let's do it. So that's Tuesday at 5:30 if you want to carpool. If not, meet us at 6 at Quinette. Friday night is our Christmas Eve services celebration. Friendly United Methodist Church will have theirs at 6, and we'll have ours at 8. Please feel free to come to whatever one fits your schedule, and if you can't be with us in person, we will be live streaming both of those, so we'll have those available online. And then, if you're not too busy 2 days later, come on back, and we'll celebrate even more of the season of Christmas at our normal times. If you'd like to give to the church this morning, there are offering plates in the back and downstairs on a little table outside the elevator. Or you can also give electronically through our website and our church app. And we appreciate all your continued support of the church. If you'd like to give to our window fund, just make checks payable to the friendly. I'll get this eventually. The Sistersville First United Methodist Church with Window Fund in the memo line, and that'll go to help support to our restoration project, which is expected to begin sometime between March and April. And we are right at halfway there. So if you'd like to give, we invite you to do that. If you are a guest with us today, I usually mention this at the beginning, but I forgot. We have welcome visitor tags, which are right in front there. You see a bunch of offering envelope sections in the pew in front of you. It's in the middle ones. We encourage you to fill that out and place that in the offering plate as you leave. That way we can thank you for worshiping with us and send you more information. And if you want to have any questions from me or anybody at the church, please feel free to put that on there as well, and we will get in touch. Same way with folks online. If you are new with us, again, let us know who you are, and we'll be happy to reach out. Any other announcements before we go? Yes, Pat.
Choir practice is right after service.
That's for those that's for choir practice is right after church. Just stay right here. Okay. Any others? Okay. If not, let's stand together and sing hymn 218, and then we'll jump over to 219. And our hymnal, starting with It Came Upon a Midnight Clear.
angels greet with anthems sweet, while shepherds watch our keeping. This is Christ the King, whom shepherds guard and angels sing. Haste, haste to bring.
Receive this benediction. Go from this place today on this final Sunday of Advent, knowing you only get a few days left. Prepare for your hearts and minds for the celebration of Christ's holy birth. Put your faith in the meaning of the season in Jesus Christ. Trust that God will lead you through any darkness, through any dangers, and lead you throughout life, bring you at long last with Him in a home made not with the hands of humans, but made by the hands of God with eternal life. Go now in peace in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.